You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Bio 190. Hopefully everybody knows my name is Kara Mathis. I'm the instructor for this class, unless of course you're just tuning in and not a student, then welcome as well. Today we're going to be talking about echinoderms and arthropods, and we have a couple things to go over that we'll do in just a few moments, but we do have a live feed from the aquarium today with Amanda and Julian. Now I know that you might not know what echinoderm or arthropod means yet, but hopefully we'll learn a little bit more about that once we go live. So I think we have Amanda ready to go. Is that right? Maybe? Okay, not. Oh, there we go. Hi, Amanda.
Hi, Kira. Okay, we are here at our touch pool in our classroom. Are you able to hear me okay?
Yeah, we've got a little bit of an echo. I don't know if that's on our end or your end.
So most of your students are probably pretty familiar with what this animal is. And this is a bat star. Now notice I didn't call it a starfish, rather a sea star is what we call these because it's not a fish. It doesn't have fins like a fish, it doesn't have a backbone like a fish, but it is an echinoderm, a spiny skin animal. And in fact, what's really cool is if you can see this right in the middle, I picked up the sea star while he was in the middle of a meal. And so that sort of blob that you see there in the middle, that is not actually his food, that's his stomach. So when they eat, they actually take their stomach out of their mouth, put it on top of whatever they're eating, and then digest it on the outside. When they're all done eating, they just slurp that stomach back in through their mouth again. So anyhow, that's what's happening here. And then on the underside of their body, they all have these tube feet, which is pretty cool. If you look at all these different echinoderms we have a lot of sea stars in here right now, but they have tube feet on the underside of their body. Let's see if we can move that over so you can see it better. I don't know if we're going to be able to get quite a good view. Oh, there we go. So if you look really carefully on the ends of the sea star, you can see those tube feet just kind of moving around. I don't know how clear your view is of that, but those are their tube feet. Now another echinoderm, which is right in front of me here, I don't know if I'll be able to grab him. Let's see if I can pry him off. We have urchins. And urchins, of course, you have to be more careful when you're trying to get off because they do have very pokey spines all over their body. Maybe I can sneak up on a different one. Oh, I need to find one who's on the pebbles on the bottom. And while I'm looking for that, maybe, oh wait, oh, what about this guy right down here? Let's see. Nope. Pick any of these up right now. But, nope. All right. Other than those guys, where is the sea cucumber? Let's see if we can find another echinoderm in here. And they're all hiding from me right now. But in between the spines, I don't know if there's any way you can zoom in. Do we have any that we can actually see from the camera? Maybe we can point out these echinoderms over here. There's a sea anemone, not that one. Let's see. We've got some more sea stars in here that were showing their tube feet there. And they also breed through those tube feet as well, which is really interesting. But over here in the corner, we can see these pokey little balls of beautifulness. These are the sea urchins, and in between their spines, they also have tube feet. So while the sea stars just have tube feet on the underside of their body that they use for, like I said, breathing and moving around and holding on to things, these sea urchins do the same thing, and sometimes you'll actually see them holding rocks and shells and things like that over their bodies to help them to camouflage. We have, let's see, there we go. This right here is a sea cucumber. So this is another echinoderm that looks a lot different than the other ones I showed you. It's really, really soft. It doesn't really have the spiny skin that the others, the way that you would, they don't feel like spiny skin. But they do have the appearance of spiny skin because when these are, you know, untouched and they're just roaming around the bottom of the tide pools, they have these spikes that kind of stick out that are actually really, really soft. And so I'm sorry the... it kind of gets blurry. But you can see right now he's all relaxed. He's kind of flopping over my hand. So you can see how flexible and soft he really is. But when he is upset, he might kind of bunch up, and you'd see all these kind of spikes sticking out from him that are actually really soft. So this is an echinoderm, but on the underside of their body, they do have tube feet. So all those little dots that you see there are the tube feet of the sea cucumber as well. And one last thing that's cool about the sea cucumber is that when he's disturbed, the way that he protects himself is by actually spitting out his guts, getting it all over the animal, trying to eat him, and then the sea cucumber can get away and grow him right back again. So echinoderms are really fascinating animals, very interesting adaptations, and you'll learn a lot more about them today. But anytime you come by the aquarium or you visit a tide pool, chances are you'll have a good chance to see lots of different types of echinoderms. So that's what we have to show you today.
Amanda, thank you so much for catching us up today about some of those echinoderms in our touch pools. Now, one thing I just want to mention before we let you go is that, of course, if you ever go tide pooling, which there are amazing opportunities for that, especially in California, you'll notice Amanda is picking up the sea stars and the sea cucumbers. Make sure you leave animals in the tide pools in the tide pools. These are ones that we use in our classrooms quite frequently. Amanda knows how to gently pick them up and put them down. So we always ask that you leave the animals as they are, especially in their natural tide pool. So, all right, Amanda, thanks for checking in with us today, and we'll see you next week.
All right, bye.
Bye, Amanda. All right, so it looks like we have lots of great questions coming in already, and our first caller, I can't wait to see who it is. Who do we have on the line today, by the way? Hi, Dominique. I even told Sandy it's going to be Dominique or Katie calling in first. What's your question for us today? Oh, I can't hear anything. I'm not sure if that is on our end or yours. Not sure. I'm not hearing anything over here. So, Dominique, stand by.
Hello?
There we go. I was going to say, there we go. Okay, go ahead. What's your question?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
I was wondering, what's the cucumber fin?
The sea cucumber. We're actually going to be talking about the sea cucumber.
And what do they eat?
And we'll be talking about that too. So that they're going to be coming up as we start to dive into the echinoderms for today. So hang tight. All right. Thanks, Dominique. Okay. Well, real quick, we're going to hold on to the questions. We have some from Darren, Adriana, and Jamie. So hold on just a second. What I want to do next is quickly go over the basic things that we go over every week. Last week, I know for the people that are watching live, you probably watched live last week. If you didn't watch live last week, it was not up on YouTube. It should be up on YouTube tomorrow. So we are going to be extending all of the deadlines for this week's work until Friday. So last week, the Polar Seas discussion board participation points and quiz will be extended until this Friday at 3:00. So don't worry if you haven't had a chance to do that. I also announced that on Blackboard and put the link up, but it'll also be up on YouTube, or it should be up on YouTube tomorrow morning. We have our midterm coming up next week that will open up. That's going to be worth 30 points. I know it's already midterm time. So that'll be, it's different than the quizzes. You only get one chance to take it. It's going to be on all the previous material from this week and previous. What else do we have? Our field trip paper that's worth 25 points is coming up. That's going to be due next week. So make sure that you have that. This is going to probably be your last time this last weekend. Or this upcoming weekend is going to be your last chance if you have to do it on the weekend, so make sure you plan accordingly. And let's see, anything else? Not so much. Discussion boards, of course, everybody knows. Continue on with the discussion boards. If you have questions about your grade, it happens where there was a typo or something like that, please email in. I do check my email every day. I try and get back to you right away as well. I am working on grading right now. I'm a little bit behind for all the participation points, but don't worry. If you submitted, then you will get credit for that. So, all right, moving on. Today we have Sandy with us. This is my second time working with Sandy for Bio190, and she's got some awesome stuff to talk about with us today, including some crab research she's done, so really exciting. So, Sandy, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
And why don't you tell everyone a little bit about how you got here and what you do and all that fun stuff.
Sure. Well, I've been with the aquarium for nearly 18 years, and I am the curator of fish and invertebrates there. Basically, my job is to oversee all of the fish and invertebrate collection that we have and help with designing new exhibits and keeping our husbandry standards in top shape. Husbandry, by the way, you might hear that word. It doesn't mean the field of husbands, as you might think. It means the care of animals and culturing them in aquarium settings or zoo settings. So we're part of the husbandry department, and I have a background in marine biology, a PhD from UCLA, and my research, as Kira mentioned, was about coral crabs, these little tiny crabs that are found just only in corals in the tropical oceans. So we'll be talking a little bit more about that later.
Awesome. All right, so today we have lots of things to talk about. Crabs are going to be more towards the end of today's lecture, but the first half is going to be about echinoderms, or those spiny skinned animals that Amanda just spent some time talking with us about. Now, when we talk about phylums, right, there are different phylums of animals. A phylum, first you would say kingdom. So what kingdom does it belong to? It would be like animal kingdom, plant kingdom, fungi, that kind of thing. We know that we're talking about the animals and the animal kingdom, but now the next branch is phylums. And the first phylum we're going to talk about are those echinoderms, but they have some special things that make them echinoderms, right?
Yeah. Echinoderms, basically the word itself means spiny skin. So that's the most obvious characteristic. This group includes the sea stars, the sea cucumbers, and sea urchins. So they all have this spiny appearance to them, and they have this radial symmetry, which means no matter how you look at them, they look the same any way you turn them, except for the sea cucumbers, which have bilateral symmetry. So they really don't have like a head or a foot or even a dorsal or ventral side. They have an oral and aboral side, and it simply means the oral side is where you find the mouth, generally on the bottom, and the aboral side is the side opposite of that on the top.
All right, and what about an endoskeleton? You said spiny skin, but they're invertebrates, right? No backbone or anything like that.
Yeah, no, they don't have a backbone. They have an endoskeleton and actually a thin layer of tissue on the outside. So just like us, our bones are on the inside. With this group, their skeleton is on the inside as well, but it's covered with this ciliated tissue. And again, some external structures that give them this spiny appearance.
And then their water vascular system, that has to do with the way they move water through their body and utilize kind of water for a lot of different things. That's a little bit unique to echinoderms too, right?
Yeah, it's actually very unique to echinoderms. This is the one group of invertebrates that has this kind of water vascular system. And they have these water-filled canals with muscular extensions called tube feet. And the tube feet extend and fill with water, and they also end in suckers. So they're used mostly for attachment and locomotion.
Oh, perfect. I love it, which we're going to talk about in just a second. Now, I want to pause here just for a moment. We have a bunch of questions coming in, so let's address some of those questions, and then we'll come back to this visual, because I thought I saw someone in here with a tube feet question, but maybe not. So, Darren, why do they call it a starfish, and how do starfish defend themselves? Well, they actually, as Amanda said, don't call them starfish. We call them sea stars now, basically because they look like a star, but they're not actually a fish, and we'll get into some of their defenses in just a little bit. Adriana, what do starfish eat? A variety of animals, which I believe we're also going to be talking about, so hang tight on that one. Okay, I thought I saw a tube feet one, maybe not. And Jimmy Jaime, I'm not sure how you say it, which one it is. And where do they store their stomach in that small body? How do starfishes move from place to place? Hang tight on the moving place to place, and we also have video of the stomach. The stomach isn't like our stomach, it's just gelatinous. It's almost like a tissue, right?
Like a bag, maybe?
Yeah, more than it is like a pouch. Like we have an organ, like a whole stomach system. Theirs is almost just like tissue that excretes stuff to digest the food and make a slurp. And you'll see a little bit more. We have a really cool video coming up to show that, but hopefully that helps to answer the question a little bit. All right, now speaking, let's go back to that visual. Sorry, I thought there was a tube question in there. So we'll go back to the visual on the 2 feet. Perfect. Can we go full screen on this again? So you were talking about 2 feet, and that's what these little guys are here. Kind of awesome. And now this is a pretty good visual. So the water essentially comes in through the madreporite. Is that right?
Yes.
And then you can see this is almost like veins, but it's not for blood. It's for water, right? So it's kind of like the same idea that the water can move through here and create pressure. Is that right, Sandy?
Yes, absolutely. And then what happens is as the 2 feet press against an object, water is released from them, which then creates a suction effect. And then when the water fills the 2 feet, the suction is released. And so this is how they actually produce locomotion. Of course, it's very slow, but it is a means of getting from one place to another. And actually, some sea stars can move very quickly.
I'm always surprised when we watch sea stars. Like, you almost think they're going to be so slow, I'm not going to notice them moving.
Yeah.
But if you stop and watch, they actually have a good little pace going.
Yeah.
So I'm always surprised, like, oh, everyone stop and watch, and you can just see them moving right along. We have a video of 2 feet kind of in action. And then in just a moment, we're gonna get there. We also have, oh no, that's the feeding one. This is gonna be 2 feet and then locomotion. So if we can go to our first video. There we go, yeah. So here's those 2 feet that you were just talking about, Sandy, kind of moving around. You can see some on the bottom there. So you were saying that when they push their 2 feet down, that releases water and then creates a suction on the end of the 2 feet?
Yeah, when the water retracts from the 2 feet, then it creates a suction. And when the water fills the 2 foot, then it releases the 2 foot, so then they can, as you can see, use one and the other to slowly move around where they want to. I think this is a bat star, actually.
Mm-hmm, yeah. And in just a moment, this clip's about a minute and a half, there's a part where we'll actually see it get moving.
And it's interesting to point out also that 2 feet also can collect oxygen and dispose of cellular waste.
So it's kind of, tube feet are kind of like the all-in-one.
Yeah, this whole water vascular system is really important to them.
All right, there we go, now it's moving. I mean, you can see it, they get moving. Like,
yeah. Yeah, and some of the bigger sunflower stars really cruise.
Oh yeah, they're fast. I mean, I guess fast in comparison, right? Okay, got a bunch of questions coming in. Let's address some of these real quick. What determines, this is from Julia, what determines the color of the sea star? I actually don't know that.
I don't know that either. There are many, many colors of sea stars. They come in all purple, orange, whatever color. And I don't think it's for camouflage because
they're not camouflaged.
They're not camouflaged. Right? Yeah. I really don't.
I mean, I think it's very similar to how, you know, we all have hair, different colors. There are just probably some sea stars over time that evolved to do better with certain colors for whatever reason. But I don't know that it's very specific, like, why is this one orange and why is this one purple? I don't know why we would say this woman has blonde hair and that woman has brown hair. I wouldn't know how to answer that. Yeah. Hale, how do sea stars reproduce and regenerate? We're getting to that, so hang tight. Darren, why do crabs pinch? Second part of this class today, so you have to wait for that. What is a crab skin made of? Hold on, we'll get to that too. And how much does a sea star weigh? There's lots of different sea stars. We go all the way from brittle stars, all the way up to, like you were saying, the sunflower stars. Do you know what an idea of what a big one would weigh?
Maybe 5 pounds at the most, I would think.
Yeah, and that probably depends on, I mean, because how much water, right?
Like, yeah, exactly.
If they've got a lot of water in their vascular system at the time, they could probably be a lot heavier. Ashley, how do sea cucumbers see? Do they have sensory adaptations or actual eyes? Hang tight, we're getting there. All right, so ecology and range for our echinoderms. There's roughly 6,000 species and they're exclusively marine.
That's
a lot.
Yeah.
I heard, oh gosh, maybe not. I was gonna say, I thought I heard about one that was in freshwater, but I don't totally remember that. So never mind. And then we've talked about intertidal zones before when we talked about our tide pool day, but they don't just live in the tide pools, right? They can live all over?
Yeah, they live all over from the intertidal to deep, deep sea, and they also range from sandy to rocky substrate bottoms, and they're found in different temperature zones. So you can find them in tropical waters, temperate waters, or even cold water.
Perfect. All right, let's go into sea stars specifically. So now that we've kind of got an introduction to the overall characteristics of echinoderms, we're going to talk about sea stars specifically, sea urchins, and sea cucumbers. So sea stars, now we had a question that came in about the stomach of a sea star and the eating. Really, really interesting. Their digestion is different. I mentioned that they have kind of this gelatinous pouch, but can you explain, walk us through how sea stars feed a little bit?
Well, sea stars are interesting in that mostly they're carnivorous. Some of them are detritivores, which means that they feed on just dead detritus and things, but they also feed on sponges, bryozoans, mollusks, and other things. And some of them are specialized feeders. They don't really have any mouth parts to capture their prey, but instead they use these tube feet with this powerful grip to hold on to their prey. And then if you take, for example, this photo of a sea star eating a clam, the reason the clam is so firmly attached to the sea star is because the sea star has extruded its stomach and pushed it into those two shells. So it's actually liquefying the clam with digestive juices so that it can sort of pull the food mass along with its stomach back into its body, and that's how it digests its food.
So it all happens externally, nothing internal. So nothing, it's not like if you think if you're gonna eat a piece of pizza, right? Like you take the pizza, you put it in your mouth, so it's now internal. Chomp, 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 swallow, 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 stomach digest. And you know, the digestive system. But with the sea star, if we were like sea stars, it would be pizza on the plate, out comes the stomach onto the pizza. Our stomach starts to release enzymes to break that pizza down, make it into a mush, a sloppy mush, starts to absorb it via the tissue of the stomach, and then right back into our mouth it goes. So very interesting way of eating. Mm. Okay, let's go address some of these questions. Abby, what other marine animals have a water vascular system? Do you know of any?
Nope.
I don't know of any offhand either. Amy, how do sea stars reproduce? Stand by, that's actually next. Katie, can a sea star survive if they lose several legs? And if so, how long does it take to grow back? Standing by. All these are upcoming, so good questions, but we're going to get to it. What is the smallest sea star? Is it a type of brittle star?
Maybe. I really don't know.
We'd have to look it up. Why don't you Google it and Jaceel let us know. Darren, how many feet does a sea star have? 2 feet, hundreds to thousands, depending on the kind that it is. So, over 6,000 species total. Lots of those are sea stars. So it's going to range quite a bit. And we have a call. So let's go straight to our caller. Who do we have today? Is it Katy Paris? Who is it? Oh, Jennifer. Jennifer, have you called in yet?
Once before.
I was going to say I wasn't anticipating your call. Okay, Jennifer, what's your question for us?
Okay, so I was watching a video, and it seemed almost like the sea star was floating along with the 2 feet to push it, kind of like a boat with oars.
Uh-huh.
And I was wondering if this is actually what is happening or if they're actually like little legs.
They're like little legs, yeah. So it's not like so she's saying it's almost like they're floating and the 2 feet are kind of holding on to the ground, like,
oh,
and kind of just paddling them along. Mm-hmm. Sea stars are kind of heavy. They've got a little weight to them. So they're going to be on the bottom. Even if their 2 feet aren't attached, they sink. So I don't know of any sea stars that float.
No.
No, they're all going to sink. So their 2 feet actually push them up. And then they're using the suction cups to pull them forward, let go, pull them forward, let go. So does that help and answer the question?
Yes, thank you.
Good. Thank you, Jennifer. Okay, looks like we have another call. Who is it? Hi, David. How's it going?
Pretty good. Yeah.
Good. What can we do for you? What's your question?
I have a question about the lab last week, about the ice cubes.
Yes.
All right, so I was wondering if there was a difference if I put the cup in the sun or if I left it in the house, because I was wondering if the sun evaporated the water and that's why I had a decrease in water.
It could. So that's a good question. It has to do, well, it's a couple of things. You're talking about the one where the ice was already in the cup, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if you think about it, if you think about ice, right, it's water and it freezes. And when it freezes, ice is actually the, or water rather, is the only one that expands when it freezes like that. It has a crystal structure. So the reason it decreased could be, yes, a little bit of evaporation. It depends on how long you left it out there. But also when the ice melts, it's taking up just actually a little bit less volume than what the ice cubes were. So the ice and the water is this, like, it's taking up volume. That's why it didn't overflow when the ice melted, because it was already accounted for. It's actually a little over accounted because of that crystal structure. Does that make sense?
Also, yeah, and also, wouldn't it be extra ceramic in the ice? I mean, the water was hotter than the ice, so the ice took in the heat, and then the, so wouldn't that also have a factor in it?
Yeah, like if the ice is like, are you talking about if the ice is bobbing outside of the water?
Yeah.
Yeah, it could a little bit. It could a little bit for sure. But usually it's about the same. That volume pretty much is accounted for.
Yeah, because I did two experiments, because I put one in the sun and one in the house and kind of try to see what the difference is because of evaporation.
How was the difference?
It was just a little bit off, you know, because the sun does, it's a lot hotter outside than it is inside.
Yeah.
So it was just a little, like, centimeters, like, millimeters off. Not much of a difference, but, you know, it did play a factor.
Yeah, for sure. And it definitely could. Evaporation totally could. Did you write that in your, I haven't gotten to the lab reports yet, but did you write in the lab reports that you did, you tried it both inside and outside to see?
I did not, actually.
Okay, well, I'll look for yours anyway. And anyway, it's awesome that you thought, like, hey, let me try it inside, too. That's super cool thinking. So awesome, David. I love your mind.
Okay.
So, all right. Thanks, David. Anything else? Oh, I think you're gone. Okay. Never mind. All right. Katie, real quick. I Googled the smallest sea star, and it is called the paddle spine sea star. It is smaller than a fingernail and discovered by Port Phillip Bay, or discovered in Port Phillip Bay in 2007. Katie, you rock. Thank you. All right. And it looks like we have Jaceel, world's smallest sea star. You want to try it?
Patriella parvovera. Para.
Yeah.
Something like that.
So I wonder, probably the same one, the paddle spine. So we have the genus species and then the common name.
Yes.
So, all right. So talking about all this feeding, one of the things that I like to talk about too is how do sea stars, without having a brain, how do they detect their food?
Well, I think when we feed them in the aquarium, it mostly seems like they depend on smell. They can somehow sense the smell of the water and in the water and then go towards it. But sea stars also can detect light and dark using modified tube feet, and these are formed into eye spots. So they can also somewhat see, but I honestly think that when they detect their food, it's through smell.
Mostly smell.
Yeah.
So I always, in like the light dark spots, I always tell people, like, close your eyes and you can sense that there's light around you, and then you cover your eyes, they're still closed and it's dark, and then it's light, and then it's dark, but you can sense the light and dark without actually seeing. So that's kind of what it's like for those, and it's at the end of each arm that you're gonna have those modified tube feet or the light dark sensing eye spots. All right, let's jump to our video. This super cool video. This has got sound, so you won't hear Sandy and I. We're probably going to be oohing and aahing over it. But this is a sea star that is feeding, and there's actually a camera inside. I think it's a mussel that this one's feeding on, and you can see the stomach in action from inside the shells of the mussel. So let's take a look at this video.
Like an advancing army, the sea stars move into position, slowly but surely working their way up toward their victims. The mussels cannot run or fight. All they can do is hide within their shells as their killers crawl over their bodies. Sensory tube feet sweep over the tightly packed mass of shells, searching for any gap in the mussel's defenses. Settling on its victim, the sea star hunkers down and begins its attack. The miniature camera, tucked within the mussel shell, gives us the first look ever at the carnage that unfolds here every day. Once the tube feet have physically breached the mussel's defensive line, the sea star's translucent stomach begins the final assault. The animal actually pushes its stomach inside the mussel's shell, unfolding like a fatal flower. The stomach unleashes a volley of chemical weapons, digestive juices that dissolve the mussel's soft pink flesh. All that's left is a nutrient-rich soup, a broth that's quickly absorbed by the sea star. Having assimilated the mussel, the sea star's stomach pulls away. The animal moves on, leaving behind an empty shell. Without the benefit of speed, brains, or brawn, sea stars are amazingly successful predators.
Pretty awesome. So that camera view where they're inside the mussel, that just always blows my mind.
Like, how do they get stuff like that? Amazing.
Crazy. But you can see like how the stomach isn't like a stomach pouch. It's just that tissue that gets in there. But it's like, bye-bye, mussel. You're gone. And you saw those 2 feet like, oh, I'm in.
Yep.
And here comes the stomach. So it's super awesome.
Very cool.
All right, Hale, how long do sea stars live for? It varies, right? I mean, like, isn't it like indefinite or something? I don't remember.
I don't know. I know there are some sea urchins that have been dated to 200 years.
Wow. So.
But I'm not sure about sea stars.
Yeah. I mean, a long time would be my guess, too. So pretty simple things. Paris, do sea stars have the ability to change color? I don't think so. I don't know of any, right? Like, They just have really vibrant colors, but they're not like an octopus that can change colors. So, all right, moving on, we're going to talk about some reproduction. And there's two types of reproduction that echinoderms and sea stars typically have. That's asexual and sexual, meaning that one is where they can kind of bud off of each other, right? And then one is actual, like, male and female. So tell me a little bit about asexual reproduction.
Well, asexual reproduction is really interesting in sea stars because a sea star can lose all but one of its arms. And as long as it has the central disc and one of its arms, it can actually regenerate its body back again, or the rest of the arms back again. So it's really cool. I think this is one of the few groups that can actually regenerate like this. If you split a sea star evenly in two, for example, then each half will grow back the missing parts. And this actually has been a problem in some tropical Pacific areas where they're trying to eradicate or get rid of the crown of thorns sea star. This has been a nuisance sea star that eats corals and is destroying a lot of our coral reefs when their numbers get too large. So some divers in the past have actually tried to chop up these sea stars to try to get rid of them and kill them, only to create more sea stars because they can have this asexual reproduction and regenerate themselves. So that's one of the unique features about sea stars.
Right, and that kind of hits the other topic of echinoderms is that they regenerate, so they can grow back parts of their body that get ripped off, just like you said. There's also sexual reproduction, which basically means they are spawning, so they're releasing sperm and egg. Those will come together and eventually settle as a larvae, and then the planktonic sea stars that we talked about a couple of times as plankton animals that eventually turn into non-plankton animals. And then as far as defense mechanisms, they typically, because we say spiny skin, right? They're typically, like, I think of a sea urchin have spines. Is that their main defense?
Primarily their main defense, but they also have these other external features that are in between the spines called pedicellaria. And sometimes These can also be like pincher-like organisms that kind of pinch away any kind of predator that's might try to bother them. But also, there can be venom in the spines, like the long-spined urchin in the tropical areas. That has venom, as well as some other urchins too, and
sure.
The Pedicellaria.
Perfect. And then the Pedicellaria on sea stars, that would be on the top of their body, is that right?
Yes.
So like if you were to look really closely at a sea star, and like they'll actually come out and retract, right? Like I'm trying to think of like when you touch them and you can see it like kind of like shrivel down, but then like sometimes it comes out. That's the Pedicellaria, right?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, so kind of cool. So if you get to the aquarium or any aquarium, you get a good look at the top of a sea star, you can see the same thing that we were just talking about. All right, let's move on to sea urchins. A couple of weeks ago during Kelp Forest Day, we mentioned sea urchins, brought up the whole Aristotle's lantern, which is like really sharp teeth that help them eat kelp, right?
Yep.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, yeah, the sea urchins are really interesting because they do have this centrally located Aristotle's lantern, and that's used primarily for grazing algae. And you can see here, many urchins also graze into the rock over time and form sort of a home scar or a home area in the rock where they like to retreat and rest. Most sea urchins are algae grazers, but some of them also feed on sponges, bryozoans, tunicates, and detritus. So yeah, they're a pretty cool animal as well.
And like you said, they have more than just the spikes, right, that are going to help. They have the I can never say it.
Pedicellaria.
Gosh. I told her, I was like, this is not one I can ever say. It never rolls off my tongue nicely. So anyway, yeah, the same thing. So look between the spines and you'll really see them kind of moving around quite a bit. All right. And then they have some symbiotic relationships where basically we're going to have two animals gaining in this case. Would that right? I mean, what kind of situations would a sea urchin pair up with something, would you say?
Well, there are many examples of sea urchins pairing up with like small shrimp, cardinal fish, a little shrimp fish, mandarin fish also. And the type of symbiotic relationship really determines whether it's beneficial for the sea urchin or not. Some of them are parasitic, but most of the time it's a commensal relationship where it's kind of neutral for both the host and the symbiont.
Got it, which makes sense. So like for example, or if like a little shrimp fish was hiding in the spikes of the sea urchin doesn't really get anything out of that.
Right.
But the little shrimp might just have protection for a little while or whatever. So, okay, and we watched this video a couple of weeks ago, but I want to show it again for the Aristotle's lantern, just so you can see those teeth. So this, again, is on the bottom. And if you were to find, like, a sea urchin test, which is essentially a dead sea urchin, could you, when you shake it, is that what you hear
yeah.
that kind of rattles around in
yeah.
there, these teeth? So let's watch this video. We're just going to show a really quick clip of it. That was hard to say. Quick clip. of the teeth again, just so you can remember what those look like. So if we can go to our third video for the kelp forest, or I'm sorry, the sea urchin video.
Holdfasts are extremely tough, but each urchin has 5 teeth, which are self-sharpening and are replaced every few months.
So you get to see, those always freak me out. I don't know, like that's such a interesting little video clip because when I look at sea urchins, I'm like, oh, the spikes, like wouldn't want to jab my hand on those, but I don't know if I would want one crawling like
I know
on my hand. I don't know, I could just imagine them like pinching my, I don't know.
Yeah, imagine all of them, like no.
No, that's
a horror
like
movie.
Horror movie, I was like, that's horror movie material. They need to come up with something like that for Hollywood. Okay, Anna, so if sea stars regenerate, does that mean that there could potentially be hundreds of sea stars with identical DNA? If so, how does the species maintain their genetic diversity? So yes, there could be hundreds out there. I don't think it's very often that sea stars get broken in half though. I don't know, would that be something that we would have to do? I mean, in what case would?
Well, I'm thinking of the recent outbreak of, there's some sea star wasting syndrome mm-hmm. up, particularly in the Northwest, but also affecting our areas, and many sea stars have died from this. So if a sea star is able to keep like one of its arms or a part of itself, then it might be able to regenerate, but I can't imagine even maybe storms kind of break them apart occasionally, like really heavy storms, but.
So I don't imagine that it's going to be like, oh no, all of these are going to break in half, create the exact same. So like not, you know, like you just mentioned, where there's not a lot of genetic diversity. I think that most of it is spawning, but it could also be asexual reproduction too. So, all right, let's move on to sea cucumbers. Good question though. Sea cucumbers, another animal in here, and these ones are always interesting. Now, you said that these ones have the bilateral symmetry, so that means if we cut it down the middle, we'd get the exact same on the right and left, right?
That's correct.
So if we just cut, oops, went to green, didn't mean to do that. Give me red, I like red, there we go. So if we cut this guy down the middle, it would be the exact same.
Yeah, just like us, where you cut us down the middle and we have the two equal halves.
Now they're deposit feeders. So they have 2 feet around the mouth that are modified into like branched tentacles, right? Like really interesting feeding. Can we show the image of the feeding tentacles, please? And go full screen. So these are the things that reach out and grab food, is that right?
Yes, this is a filter feeding type of sea star, and this one has tentacles with branched filaments that capture plankton in the water and then fold it into their mouth, which is located in the center of all those tentacles.
That's such an interesting view. I mean, that's nothing like the sea star or the sea urchin, but kind of interesting.
Yeah.
And then as far as their defense, they look like they have spines. That's why they fit into the spiny skinned phylum, right? But they don't really actually have spines.
No, not really. And as you could see when Amanda was picking that up, it was really kind of soft and gelatinous. But some of them, like in the photo that we just saw, they do have sort of a hard external structure, so they are a bit tougher. But for the most part, they don't have any real defensive mechanism. Mm-hmm. So what they really depend on is secreting toxins. And they do, like if a predator tries to taste them, they'll just taste bad. And I think that's why some of the coloration patterns that you get warns predators that, hey, I might taste bad.
Mm-hmm.
But they also have some other unique defensive mechanisms, including the ability to discharge sticky filaments through their anus to potentially discourage predators. So if a predator is trying to pick on it, it will discharge its these filaments, and maybe the predators will be more interested in the filaments, as you can see in this photo.
So this part right here.
Yes, exactly. And maybe they think it's a worm or something that the fish could pick at. So it kind of gives them a chance to get away.
And then they also really utilize the fact that they can regenerate, because they're an echinoderm. One of those characteristics is regeneration, as we've already seen with the sea star and sea urchin. But these guys will expel their guts. So they're like, hey, something's trying to eat me. Hey, eat this instead. Bleh! And then out it comes. And then they have to regenerate all of their internal parts that they just expelled. And we were reading papers on this last year. I think we talked about it too, that they do it anyway. Even if they don't, if nothing was picking on them and it had been a couple months, they actually expel and regrow anyway. It's almost like a fresh set.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Sharks sometimes do that. We see that with sharks at the aquarium.
Yeah.
They'll discharge their, the gland, I forgot the digestive gland, to do the same thing, to clean it.
Ooh.
Interesting.
Yeah, so that evisceration process is kind of an interesting defense in itself. These guys, well, actually, hold on. Before we talk about some of these symbiotic relationships, which the pearlfish just grosses me out.
Oh, yeah.
We'll talk about that in a second, but let's go to the questions. Ashley, what are the main predators of sea stars and how do they react to predators? What mostly eat sea stars?
That's a very good question.
Like, I know otters, right? Otters.
Otters will
eat
sea stars.
I've seen seagulls picking at them before.
Yeah. But I know that it's a big problem because the crown of thorns sea stars, for example, they're trying to get rid of them because of these outbreaks. And there is one snail, the Triton's trumpet, and it's the only known predator to this particular sea star. So I think they're few and far between, honestly.
Yeah, and I mean, we've talked about a keystone species and how important they are to maintaining balance. So, you know, we don't often talk about, well, what's preventing sea stars from keeping balance? It's more like we need to let sea stars maintain the balance. So, yeah, nothing other than just kind of some of those other smaller ones come to mind. Amy, what do sea cucumbers eat and how long do they live? So we mentioned some of the things that they eat. I don't know how long they live. I think it's the same I deal with it. I don't know. Like, I don't know what their life's in. I think it's really hard to judge. I guess you have to follow it from the time it's hatched, right, as a little larvae in the tide pool to the end, and hard to know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
One just addition to what they eat. We mentioned that some sea cucumbers are filter feeders, mm-hmm. but in addition, there are some sea cucumbers that have these modified tentacles around their mouth that are also deposit feeders. So they go along the bottom of the seafloor looking for detritus and other things that are mixed in the sand, and they actually pick those up and ingest them and then eat sort of the bacteria and stuff around the sand grains. And this has been great for us in the aquarium because we actually use them in our aquariums to help clean up the bottom of the tanks so that mm-hmm. it keeps it nice and fresh.
Yes. Yeah. They're kind of fun looking when they're feeding. I don't know, when they're just feeding and you just see the branching, it's so crazy.
Yeah.
So the symbiotic relationships that they have, the one that I really want to highlight is the pearlfish. This pearlfish actually lives inside the sea cucumber, right?
Yes, it actually does. It lives in the anus of the gut cavity, but it enters and leaves through the anus, tail first, and it feeds on the gonads and the tissues of the sea cucumber. Now you wonder how the sea cucumber can survive. I'm guessing that the pearlfish probably only nibbles enough to sustain itself, and then since the sea cucumber can regenerate those organs, it just can keep up with the pearlfish's needs.
That grosses me out. I don't think I'll ever be okay with that. So anyway, yeah, as you can see, literally comes out of the anus there and goes right back in. So not a fan. Real quick, JC, I know that in certain parts of Asia, for example, India and Japan, sea cucumbers are eaten as a food. Since they secrete a toxin, how do they get rid of the poison? Well, not all of them are going to secrete a toxin, right? It's not all of them. My guess is that if they do, and I'm not super familiar with this, but if they did eat toxic ones, it's probably not toxic to us. Mm. Or they would
avoid those parts. I know with sea urchins, for example, they only eat the reproductive organs, right. The gonads. And I know that there are venomous sea urchins as well, like they have venom in their spines, but obviously it doesn't affect their reproductive organs. So maybe it's something similar with sea cucumbers.
Yeah, for sure. Anna, do you think that humans could study the evisceration and regeneration process to mimic the DNA of these organisms, thus leading to human beings being able to do this? That's a great question. I don't know that would work. I'm sure that it has been looked at, but our DNA is so different that I don't know if it could be done. I'm sure it's been looked at, but we're just so different. I don't know how that would work. Yeah,
they might be able to isolate that someday and insert it into a human, but I don't know. I think we're a long way away.
Yeah, I mean, that's wishful thinking, for sure, and I would love it. I mean, even what they're doing with stem cell, you know, and like I just saw, they were able to get a 3D printed heart pumping.
Oh,
yeah, just recently I saw it. So
crazy.
Yeah, super cool. So all right, with that, we're going to stop there. Well, actually, real quick, a couple other things. Some unique species to look at in echinoderms are sand dollars, which are very flattened. You've probably seen these sand dollars. People like to collect these. Obviously, we like to leave them at the beach where they belong. And then the heart urchin, which is another one that you can definitely look up and see that it's a little bit of a different looking animal. So, okay, with that, we'll go ahead and go to our break here in just a moment. So about 5 minutes to get a drink or get a snack, do whatever you got to do. And then we will come back and jump into crustacean. So we'll see you in just a couple minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride.
We'll be right back.
You have to want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
You are in control of your destiny.
Do well. Go Toros.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. So hopefully you had a good break. We're going to jump right into crustaceans. Crustaceans are totally different than echinoderms, and actually the phylum is arthropoda or the arthropods, but crustaceans are basically like the water arthropods, right? Is that
yes.
How we would describe
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
So yeah, so we're gonna jump in, but let's define what an arthropod is. When I say the word arthropod, typically people think of bugs. I would think. I mean, when I hear arthropod, I think of bugs too. But let's describe what makes an arthropod, and then we'll apply it to the oceans.
Yeah, so arthropods are, they include insects, crabs, shrimp, millipedes, even the extinct trilobites are arthropods. They're everywhere, and they're a very large, diverse group. At least half of the 1.4 million species that have been described ever in the animal kingdom are arthropods. And of course, most of that is made up of insects. Their fossil record dates back to about 530 million years, so about the time of the Burgess Shale. Now, they do have a long evolutionary history, so we have many different types of arthropods. They have a great size range, and they've adapted to a wide variety of niches. Their close relationships and coevolution with plants and algae have even provided more radiation of arthropods in the fact that they have lots of different niches that they can fill. They were the first flying animals, and this, of course, allowed them to fill even more niches. But it's really this combination of segmentation and jointed legs that has allowed them to manipulate their body plan over the evolutionary history that has given us so many arthropods.
And we'll kind of jump into that a little bit. Like you said, they're segmented bodies, and that's one of the big things. When I think of the word arthropod, I think of jointed appendage. Like, I always like, if you can joint their legs, you have an arthropod. Like, exactly. Anything that has, like, if I just want to go joint, if yep. You can just joint it, then you have an arthropod. So hopefully that helps when thinking, okay, is that an arthropod or is that something else? That'll help you realize that if it's got a jointed appendage, it is an arthropod. That means that they have segmented bodies as well. So there's a head, a thorax, and an abdomen. So we have, yeah, perfect. We'll take a look here. Well, these are the jointed appendages here that I was talking about. Real quick, we'll come back to the other one, but jointed appendage, right? Jointed appendage. We have the jointed appendage. Jointed appendage. So lots of different jointed appendages. Even like up here, you can like, there's joints up there. So can we go to the other one real quick? The segmentation. Let's go straight into that full screen visual if we can. There we go. So Sandy, talk to me about the head, thorax, and abdomen. What are we looking at here?
Well, the head is really where the lobster's eyes and antenna are located. The thorax is equivalent to our chest, for example, and it's where many of the internal organs are located. And then the abdomen is what is composes the tail, and that's really where a lot of lobsters and crabs get their movement from. They can use this for swimming or for even defense in some cases.
And so kind of coming back, jointed, 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 right, jointed.
Yeah.
So lots of different joints there. And then these ones, I think we had a question about their skeleton earlier, right? I want to say about the exoskeleton.
Yes.
I thought we had a random meeting in the class that had to do about their exoskeleton. So they have an exoskeleton, so it's kind of like hard plates on the external part of their body, but they're also invertebrates, right? So no backbone for these guys.
Right, no backbone. But the exoskeleton, unlike the echinoderms, which had the endoskeleton, the exoskeleton kind of limits them as far as growth goes. So they have to go through a process of molting in order to grow.
And what makes up that exoskeleton?
It's a really a high molecular weight polysaccharide called chitin. Mm. And it's kind of like our fingernails.
Okay. And then, so like you were saying, they actually have to grow. So like if they're going to grow bigger, they have to get out of the old kind of like skeleton, it's not skeleton, but endoskeleton that they created and then harden up a new one.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So kind of, oh, you know what? That's what I wanted to get was the molting video.
Oh.
I'm gonna try and find the molting video. I'm gonna make Sandy talk about something awesome and then I'm gonna Google it over here. So, so they go through this molting, which allows them to get rid of their old kind of external skeleton and then create a new one. They also have compound eyes, which is kind of cool too, right?
Yeah, compound eyes are interesting. A lot of insects have this as well. Well, actually, it is a defining characteristic of arthropods, but compound eyes are just distinct photoreceptive units, and they're good for detecting movement. Like you can tell when, say, your hand goes over them or something, you could see them move out of the way, but they're not visually very accurate. So they don't have an acute sense of like sharp eyesight like we do. And really the amount of overlap determines how great the visual acuity is.
So. Right. Yeah. So those are the things that basically make an arthropod. So we've got segmented bodies, jointed appendages, exoskeleton, and the compound eyes. But yeah, I mean, it's kind of crazy when you think about a fly, right? Like you can never swat them.
Yeah.
Like they see it coming. They see that fly swatter. So they can detect lots of movement pretty well. All right. And there are essentially four major groups of arthropods.
Yes. They include the trilobites, the chelicerates, the insects, and the crustaceans. And that's what we'll be talking about today. Now, the trilobites are an extinct group. There are about 4,000 different types of trilobites, but they no longer exist. They dominated the seas during the Cambrian period over 440 to 550 million years ago. And they were a significant group until the Permo-Triassic mass extinction, about 290 million years ago. They were exclusively marine, and they were benthic, which means they crawled along the ocean bottom, and only a few centimeters long. Some of them were scavengers, but some of them could also have been predators.
Those aren't around anymore.
No, those aren't around anymore.
So the ones that are around, though, like the chelicerates, for example, those would be like, now this is, I said, right, ocean-going arthropods would be like crustaceans, but except for horseshoe crabs,
yes.
Right? Horseshoe crabs don't belong to the crustacean family. They're chelicerate, but they're really interesting.
Yeah, they're more closely related to spiders than they are to true crabs, and they have been around for a long, long time. This is a unique group. They are mostly found off of our eastern shore of Americas, lots of them, and they're very important in our medical field as well for testing whether certain medicines are sterile or not by using the horseshoe crab's blood to test for this. So
yeah,
it's kind of interesting.
Really, really important to the medical industry for sure. That would be another video. I'm going to make a note about blue blood. And they have blue blood, which kind of makes it cool as well, because they don't have iron as the oxygen binding element. For us, we have iron. When iron hits oxygen or oxidizes, it turns red. And then them, copper is the one that's carrying the oxygen around, right?
Yeah.
So when that hits oxygen, it turns blue.
Yeah.
Kind of interesting. Real quick, this is just my own off-script question for you, if you know. With the horseshoe crabs, what makes them more like a spider specifically than, do you know? Like,
I don't.
I'll have to look that up.
I'm sure it has something to do with its anatomy, mm-hmm. like its physical makeup, but I don't know.
All right, I want to look that up. So, okay, and then of course there's insects, which we've already talked about, and then crustaceans, which we're actually going to spend most of the time talking about today. Crabs, lobsters, shrimps, and believe it or not, barnacles, but once we take a closer look at the barnacles, I think you'll agree that perfect example of an arthropod. Arthropods, I mean, especially since there are so many of them, are pretty important animals overall, right?
Yeah, very important. They play a critical role in our food web, for example. They are considered pests, many of them, when you think about insects and things that eat our crops, for example. But they also make up a large portion of our food. So they're important to us economically and biodiversity-wise, of course, since they make up half of the 1.4 million species, then we can count on them to give us biodiversity in the world, which
right.
is really important.
Absolutely. All right, now with crustaceans, there are approximately 67,000 species. So that figure is twice the number of all amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals combined. Mm-hmm. Again, just to see like so many different things out there, mostly are marine, some are freshwater, There are some semi-terrestrial from deep sea to tops of mountains. And I'm thinking of like crayfish, right? Like you can find crayfish like in rivers and stuff like that, right?
But there are also terrestrial crabs.
That's
like,
right.
On Christmas Island, they live on land, but they still have to go to the sea to reproduce.
Uh-huh.
To release their eggs, they still release the eggs in the ocean, but then when the juvenile crabs come back, they go up to land and they live most of their life on land.
That's crazy.
Yeah, isn't it wild?
That's really crazy. They also range in size. So we have from the largest, which is the giant Japanese spider crab, which could have a 12-foot leg span, to the smallest, which lives in the entangles of the copepod. So that's like micrometers, like teeny, teeny, tiny. So here's a spider crab. We have some of those at the aquarium. And they're not like, their body's not huge. It's really their legs that make them huge, right?
Yes, and it's really interesting when, how we get these to the aquarium is from a collector in Japan. They are Japanese giant spider crabs. And when they ship them to us, they have to actually put rubber bands around those long legs to keep them from damaging them during the shipping process.
Super crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's another video. Hold on. There's all these videos that are coming to mind for me of things I want to show you guys. So, okay. All right, we have a couple questions. Abby, how often do they molt? That's definitely going to depend on the type of animal that we're talking about. I think like horseshoe crabs, they molt like multiple times the first year as they're growing because they're quickly growing. Mm-hmm. And then it's way less frequently to the point where I don't think that they molt as adults. Is that right?
Horseshoe crabs, I've rarely, not at the aquarium, we've never seen a large one molt, but interestingly, our local spiny lobsters molt every year at the same time.
Oh my gosh.
Every September, October, now is the time. And I think what's really interesting is that the ones in our aquarium molt at the exact same time as the ones in the wild.
Huh.
And yet the ones in our aquarium have no external cues as far as natural lighting or temperature or anything.
And the food stays the same all the time.
Yeah.
So that's really weird.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Interesting. Okay. Alethea, I think. I hope I said your name right. Is it true that a crab's muscle is a liquidy substance?
Not really. It has a liquidy substance around it called hemolymph, which you mentioned the blue blood.
Right.
It's like a clearish liquid that oxygenates the tissues, but when it's exposed to air, it turns blue.
Got it, yeah. I mean, if you think about it, when you eat crab legs, you're eating muscle, right?
Yes.
So when you're eating crab legs, that's the muscle that you're eating. So there would be maybe some of that stuff around there before you clean it. Is that right?
Yeah.
So anyway, just if you've ever thought about that, when you eat meat, you're generally eating muscle. Amy, are chelicerates found on land as well as in the ocean? Well, yes, because that includes spiders. But like horseshoe crabs, for example, they will come on land to reproduce, but they do spend a lot of their time in the water. And Julia, are horseshoe crabs the only chelicerates? No, I'm in the ocean.
No, there are sea spiders, I believe are also chelicerates.
Right, yeah. Good. Okay, and it looks like we have a phone call. So who do we have on air with us today? Hi, Paris. How's it going?
Good. I was wondering, you said that the only crustaceans that live on land are these crabs that go back to the water to breed. But I was thinking, what about hermit crabs?
Yeah, no.
Don't they like not live in the water? Don't they only like drink the water? Because you can have them like in your little terrarium at home.
Right, yeah, no, that's, we were just naming some examples, but yeah, hermit crab, there's some hermit crabs, like tropical hermit crabs, for example, or tropical rainforest, right, hermit crabs. Those are the ones that they typically sell in like pet stores, right?
Yes, but there are also coconut crabs, which are also terrestrial.
Right, yeah, so no, there are definitely others. We just use that one as an example. All right, thanks, Paris. But yeah, you were definitely right about the hermit crabs is another example. All right, so let's talk about some definite or some things that define crustaceans specifically. So they also have a body composed of the head, thorax, abdomen. They have a pair of appendages on each body segment, and that makes them kind of different, right? So if we could pull up a picture of crustacean segmentation, I think we have a krill. Was it a krill or was it the
shrimp? Maybe.
Maybe. Let's go full screen on this guy here. So what we mean by that is the pair of appendages on each body segment. We have a body segment, 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 right? Is that, that's what they're talking about?
Mm-hmm.
And then there's these ones up here. So each segment is going to have a pair of legs. All right, five segments on the head. What are they talking about there?
It includes like the different types of mouth parts. There are lots of different paired appendages.
Like,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What else?
And then two pairs of antennae.
So we got our antennae here and here.
Mm-hmm. The long ones. There's usually a long set and then a short set. Like above those longer ones that you just highlighted.
Like here.
Yes. Unless that those are spines, but I can't really tell. But
yeah, this is a drawing.
There's always two pairs of antennae and then the compound eyes.
Right. Compound eyes. Absolutely.
Okay. So those are the major characters defining crustaceans.
And then we'll quickly go through some of the major groups. One includes copepods. There's about 12,000 species, and they are really small oftentimes. There are some whales that feed on them that are, that have some of the, like the bigger copepods, and then there are also like teeny tiny ones. Anything special about
Copepods, interesting for me, is that I read a statistic that they make up 95% of the zooplankton in the ocean, which is just phenomenal to me.
Hold on, I have to take a drink of water. I feel hiccups coming on. Talk about copepods some more.
Well, yeah, so at the Aquarium of the Pacific, actually, we breed and reproduce copepods so that we can feed many of our fish babies this small animal because, like I said, it's an important part of our food chain, and in fact, it's one of the more important, extremely important as a primary consumer in the food web. So it's eating the phytoplankton, and it's one of the first zooplankton that you see near the bottom of the food chain.
Mm-hmm. Then let's move on. So copepods are different than amphipods,
yes.
Right? Amphipods are kind of like they're squished from the sides, is that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, squished laterally.
Yeah, so I think we have a picture of an amphipod. This is another one, about 8,000 species. They range from 1 millimeter to the giant sea benthic species, reaching 25 centimeters. Some are parasitic, some that will inhabit jellies or salps and eat their tissue. And then there are many different feeding strategies, including scavenging, suspension feeding, and like I said, they're squished laterally, so that means they're squished from the sides, which is a little bit different. And then we've got isopods. Lots of these guys, too.
Yeah, isopods are cool. Rather than being squished laterally, they're actually squished from compressed dorsoventrally. So this is a picture of a giant isopod. We have those at the Aquarium of the Pacific if you'd like to see them in real life. In general, there are about 10,000 species of isopod. They're found in marine, freshwater, and terrestrial habitats. Roly-polies, or pill bugs, are actually isopods. So that's an example of a terrestrial isopod. They can be quite small, from 0.5 millimeters up to about 50 millimeters, or 500 millimeters, which is about 19 inches. And I believe the giant isopod might be one of the largest, if not the largest isopod. Many of them are scavengers, but some are parasites. We actually find some of the smaller isopods attached to the gill chamber of many of our fishes when we first bring them in.
I have to stop us, Sandy. I forgot to do the mystery.
Oh.
Oh my gosh, we have to go to the mystery so I can give you guys a chance to answer since we only have about 15 minutes left of class.
Okay.
Can we pull up the picture? Sorry. They probably hate me in the control room right now. yes, so we have two things. One, of course, is what is this animal? And, oops, looks like we have time. There we go. So what is this animal? We need to know what that is. So that is our mystery animal. And go ahead and type or call us in, let us know, and we'll let you know when you get it right, and then we'll go to the question of the day. So, okay, here we go. Moving on. So the isopods, we have a really cool picture of an isopod, which we actually, I just realized we named the parasitic isopod an parasitic copepod. But it was an isopod.
Well, there are parasitic copepods, though, too.
The one that I think that we saw, if we can bring up the picture, I don't remember what we labeled it when we found it, but it's the one that has the isopod as the tongue in the fish.
Oh, those are the ones I hate.
Yes, these ones are another like horror movie waiting to happen.
Yeah.
So, yes, yeah, so these ones will actually eat the tongue of fish, and they'll take over the blood supply of the fish, so that's how they're getting some nutrients, and then they eat... things in the fish's mouth.
Yes. These are the same ones that you find in the gill chamber of the fish as well, on the side. And when we try to remove them manually when we first get a fish to the aquarium and it might have one of these isopods, and trying to pull them off is nearly impossible because they have these tiny hooks at the very ends of their legs and they really dig in. They're tough to get out.
And they like eat the do they eat the tongue? Is that what they're doing?
I'm not sure if
something
they actually
gross.
Eat it, but it is, it's a great place to be because it gets, you know, everything it needs, fresh water coming into the fish's mouth and everything.
Yeah, kind of gross. All right, we're going to move on quickly to hermit crabs. We actually have a crab that we want to dissect, so we're going to move kind of quickly through the next couple of sections, and then we will, Sandy's going to get it ready. And then we have a couple things to go through real quick, but we'll get there in just a second.
Okay.
So hermit crabs, one that we've talked about before. Now, their abdomen is soft, usually asymmetrical, and their abdomen fits into a shell. So this is without a shell. Let's pull this picture. There we go. Full screen. No shell. This is their body that's curled into itself right here. And that kind of unfolds and hooks into a shell, right?
Yeah. And you see those the last pair of walking legs? It's a really tiny stump right above
here?
The coil. Yes, that is a modified pair of legs. So whenever you see a hermit crab, you usually only see four pairs of legs, including the claws. And hermit crabs have this modified fifth pair that's used to hold the shell on. So it aids it in keeping its house on its back to protect that soft body.
And then one thing I want to make note of is that when the hermit crabs do move into a shell, the shell was not made by the hermit crab. It was made by another animal. So I think everybody, for the most part, knows that. One of the things that I'm going to challenge you to find out, which you'll learn about in the next week or two, is where does that shell come from? It's not from the crab, but where does it come from? All right, we have true crabs, which we're going to hold off on talking about because we're going to show them essentially a true crab, right?
Okay.
They have five pairs of legs, but not always. And then the front pair are usually modified pinchers. So we'll show them that in a minute.
Okay.
There's also shrimp. Shrimp are another example of a crustacean. They often occur in pairs. There are some that are cleaner shrimp, like this one right here is actually cleaning off the dead skin of the little clownfish there. And then we're gonna jump in here to the lobsters. I just wanna touch base on a couple of these real quick. Now, our lobsters are a little bit different because they do not have big claws.
Right.
They're not claw lobsters. A lot of times people think of lobsters, oh, they have claws. Ours are spiny lobsters, so they have spines that make them. If you were to try and pick it up, might not have claws to pinch you, but that thing is going to be whipping back and forth, and it will definitely, it can give you a good little poke.
Yeah.
And then barnacles. We have a video of barnacles feeding. Barnacles are ones that are little animals that will attach their heads and cement their heads down, secrete their exoskeleton, and then they use their like foot essentially to filter out little animals, but that foot is a jointed appendage. So why don't we show this video, and then we are going to go right into Sandy's crab and look a little bit more at a crab. So we've got about a 30-second video, and then we'll dive into this crab, quite literally. So there's those jointed appendages I was talking about, but they can do it many jointed appendages there, and they'll come out multiple times and just capture plankton. So kind of interesting. All right. Perfect. Okay, so real quick, let's go here. We've got a couple. Paris, you wrote in, it is a harlequin shrimp. You are right. So it is a harlequin shrimp. And today's question of the day, I noticed there was a typo on it, but that's okay. It was probably my writing that they couldn't read. But the question of the day is, what do harlequin shrimp eat? So a couple other guesses was sea dragon, and then a couple other people had the harlequin shrimp as well. So good job, you guys got it on first try, which is pretty good. I don't know if that's helped you there since that popped up, but what do they eat? So there's a typo there, H-A-R-L-E-Q-U-I-N, what do harlequin shrimp eat? Question of the day, if you need to get some extra points, of course, go ahead and submit that under the assignments. Okay, talk to me about your crab here.
Well, this is a rock crab that I guess is half eaten. So please forgive me if you get an overview shot of this. Basically, we wanted to show you just some of the basic characteristics of crabs. True crabs have five sets of jointed appendages. Now, of course, the guy at the seafood market gave me this crab for this class, but unfortunately, because it was half eaten, I'm sorry, it's not a complete set of crab legs here, but usually it does have five pairs of legs. This one has this last one missing, so usually there would be another pair. But the interesting thing that I wanted to show you are these big claws. This is again a local crab that you find here, but you can see it's got these big pinching claws here. Some claws are modified for cutting and thus would have very sharp inner edges of the claws, and others are for crushing, which have very blunt edges. You can tell male and female crabs by turning them over and looking at the underside. A female will have a very wide abdomen. Again, we talked about the different segments. You have the head, the thorax, or the chest area, and then the abdomen. But in crabs, the abdomen is tucked under its body, unlike a lobster or a shrimp whose abdomen stays out straight. So if I were to open this up, you could see there are the same structures that you would find on the underside of a lobster. These are called pleopods, and these filaments actually hold eggs. In this case, this is a female with a very wide abdomen, and these pleopods hold eggs onto the body so that they can develop there right under the female. Males will have a much smaller apron here, and it will look more like a Washington Monument than the Washington Capitol. That's one way.
We actually have pictures standing. Can we jump to the pictures? I don't know if that's easy to do. If we can go show the male female crab pictures. I think we have those. We can just show and kind of come
sure,
back. And,
sure,
here we go. Yeah, so we can pull this full screen.
Oh, yeah, that's perfect. So you can see the one on the
which one you want to do
right.
First?
You're right, Kara. Yeah, that's a male. And you can see it looks more like a Washington Monument, very tall and skinny. And then the female has the very wide apron like the Washington Capitol. So these are blue crabs. They're found on the East Coast, but the same principle applies here.
And then can we go to the picture of the crab egg? So like you were saying, the female will have them tucked underneath. We have a picture of the crab eggs as well.
Oh, very nice.
So all these right here, they're teeny tiny. You might be able to make it out. Those are a bunch of eggs.
Yeah, there are millions of eggs, and you can see the filaments sort of hold the eggs in mass all together. And the female will hold the eggs for a few weeks, a few days. It really depends on the species and how long the gestation period is. But so that's the crab. And then if we go back to the crab here, I can show you. So if for those of you who know, we have the crab basically has these different jointed appendages up here. Remember we said there are five jointed appendages on the head alone. And then just to show you some of the internal structures here, actually this is kind of interesting. I haven't really seen this on many species of crabs, but you can see the reproductive organs here. These are called gonopores, and this is where the male will insert a spermatophore into the female, and then she will lay eggs through here, and the eggs will be passed onto these filaments and be fertilized as it passes by the spermatophore. So if I turn this over and just stick my thumb under the back part of this apron and lift this up, we should be able to see some of the internal anatomy of the crab.
Yes.
Wow. Okay, there we go. So, some interesting things here. These items over here, these brown masses, are the gills. So as water flows in through the mouth, it circulates through the body cavity and then passes over the gills and back out again, actually in an opening near the front of the head. So that's kind of interesting. The heart is located here in the back. This is all reproductive tissue, the orange that you see there, and it's really hard to see anything else, but another, like we were talking about, every appendage was paired. Even these appendages, which are small, fine gill cleaner filaments on the inside, there should be another one over here too, but I think that one was eaten.
Didn't make it.
Yeah. So basically, that's the basic anatomy of a crab. Very simple, and of course, if we were to break that even more, we would see the internal musculature and all of that sort of thing.
Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Now, real quick, just we were talking about reproduction. We've talked a little bit about how they're, when the eggs hatch, they're planktonic, right? So we have Nauplii and Zoea that'll eventually settle and turn into, like, they'll be able to hold on, right, as they're developing into a crab and then become animals that can, now can they swim?
The larvae?
No, the crabs. The actual adult crabs.
Some of them can swim. Some of them have modified legs. The very last set of legs will be modified into paddles, and they can flip around and actually swim. The one here, the rock crab, is more of a walking type of crab. It doesn't have those modifications, so.
Yeah, pretty cool.
Yeah.
All right, and we have about a minute and a half or so left. So Sandy has done some amazing research. You mentioned that you had your PhD. In the next minute or half or so, do you want to just kind of tell everyone some of the research that you've done in case you love crabs and this has inspired you? What are some of the things that you have done that can maybe continue to inspire?
Well, I am fortunate enough to have found someone that was part of a National Science Foundation grant many years ago. And this grant was designed to train students in taxonomy, which is the classification of animals. And this particular grant focused on crustaceans. So my project, I was very interested in tiny little coral crabs. These are crabs that are no more than an inch or two long, and they are found exclusively in stony corals. I think we may have a picture
of
them.
I think we might have had a picture. I don't remember where it was, but they're
at the very end, maybe the coral crab.
Oh yeah, there it is. One of the last pictures was the coral crab.
So the what I did for the grant was I basically was able to travel to different islands in the Pacific Ocean and look for these coral crabs and identify new species. For those of you who are interested in going into marine science, I would really suggest, this area, we're really trying to get a census of marine life and look for biodiversity. Mm-hmm. And so discovering new species is always a great thing. And I think there's a lot of money in it. So if you're interested in that type of thing, and I was lucky enough to describe 4 new species.
Wow.
So that's what my project really focused on.
Really cool.
Yeah.
Really awesome. So there's always so many branches that you can get into when it comes to marine biology. And while you guys are up and coming, if any of you love marine biology, start volunteering, figure out what it is that really drives you, whether it be crabs or whales or sharks or whatever it might be. So, all right, that pretty much wraps up our session. Sandy, thank you for coming.
Oh, you're welcome.
Showing
thank
us
you.
The crab, talking about your research, 4 new species. That's something special.
Yeah.
And everyone, thanks for all your participation today. Really good job. Don't forget, discussion board opens up today. Quiz opens up. We're going to be doing the midterm next week. It's going to be 30 points. And want to make sure that you study up for it because you only get one chance to take it. There's an extension for last week's stuff, so that'll be open until Friday. If you have any questions, email me. I'll get back to you. Otherwise, we will see you next week.